Perhaps the people have changed, but the sea and the land, the west coast of Chichagof Island, are as they were since before human memory. Long the domain of the Tok Dang Tong, a Tlingit group from Juneau, the rugged coastline with its promise of freedom and riches drew whites from all over the globe. They came around the turn of the century, spurred on by tales of gold in California, the Klondike, and Juneau. They would find the gold. However, the era of the rugged individualist was already dying. The era of high finance, corporate enterprise, and the honest wage earner was already here. Thousands of years ago, the glaciers receded from what is now southeast Alaska. But the land itself was not stable. Violent forces within the earth split the rock, forming long, deep cracks or faults. From deep within the earth, molten rock and hot water rose through the cracks towards the surface. Formations like this are the result of the intrusion of molten rock from below into the surface rock, filling in the faults. The hot water deep in the earth had many minerals dissolved in it. When this rich solution of minerals rose through the faults, it arrived at places where conditions were right for the dissolved minerals to crystallize or become solid deposits. So it was that gold was deposited along the Hirst Fault and the Chichagof Fault. It was 1905. Ralph Young and his uncle Frank Newell had just discovered gold in Clag Bay, 50 miles north of Sitka. Ralph Young would later become one of the founders of the Alaska Native Brotherhood. Not very far away, however, there was more gold waiting to be discovered. This is the story of that second discovery, the Hirst-Chichagof gold mine. After word of the Clag Bay discovery had spread, Sitka was bristling with talk of gold and prospecting. Stampeders tumbled in from all over the world. Two Russians arrived after drinking and brawling their way up the west coast from San Francisco. They changed their names to Peter Romanoff and Andrew Dixon. Having spent much time in Sitka's bars, they managed to convince John Clements, a bar owner, to grubstake them with a boat, food, and liquor. They set out 50 miles through passages and open water along the coast in a rowboat with a sail. After several months, they returned with no success. Clements refused to stake them a second time. Undaunted, they went to Bernard Hirst, a grocer, to seek his help. The son of a wealthy English family, Hirst joined the U.S. Navy and was stationed in Sitka. Upon his discharge in 1895, he collected his family inheritance of $4,000 and used it to start his grocery. Hirst spoke with a very distinct British accent and was most formal in his dealings with people. With his red hair and mustache, always impeccably dressed in a suit, tie, and often wearing a bowler hat, he was the most dapper figure in town. He was known to be precise, honest, and shrewd. Later in life, after having made, lost, and then remade several small fortunes, he would say, "When I followed my hunches, I made money. When I listened to the bankers, I lost it." This time, Bernard Hirst followed his hunch and staked Romanoff and Dixon for another chance at prospecting. Fortified with food and, of course, liquor, the two cantankerous prospectors went back out to the west coast of Chichagof Island. They found gold-bearing rock here at the base of Duluth Mountain in Kimshan Cove. On December 20th, 1905, Romanoff, Dixon, and Hirst filed as partners on the claim. Very little happened to the claim until 1917, when Hirst bought out Dixon and Romanoff's share for $5,000. In 1927, Hirst would sell his share in the mine for about $150,000. There were at this time several wealthy persons of Chinese descent living in the Pacific Northwest. Goon Dip had come to the United States as a young boy. He entered business as a merchant, but made his fortune contracting Chinese and Filipino laborers to railroads and canneries in the Northwest. Through his connections with Alaska canneries, Goon Dip met Juneau businessmen who interested him in investing in gold mining. In 1918, the Hirst-Chichagof Mining Company was formed, with Hirst, C.W. Freeze, and Goon Dip as partners. $1 million in stock would be sold, most of it owned by Goon Dip and other prominent Chinese Americans. He was appointed consul to Washington and Alaska by the Imperial Government of China, thus becoming the Honorable Goon Dip. A mountain on Chichagof Island would be named for him, as would the workboat at the mine, the Consul D. Mining engineers use a method called diamond core drilling to discover what minerals exist under the surface and where they are located. A special drill bit is attached to the end of a hollow tube. The drill bit is also hollow and has industrial diamonds set into its cutting edge to cut the subsurface rock. When the apparatus is pulled back to the surface, there is a 5-foot core of rock within the tube. This core is taken from the tube and stored with other cores taken earlier from the same spot. When geologists examine the collection of cores, they can determine what minerals are present and how far down in the earth they lie. By comparing the cores from two different nearby spots, they can determine the direction in which ore deposits run and their angle of inclination. Extension shafts are added to the drilling rig, which enable the bit to go deeper into the earth. Dan Williams, a mining engineer from Montana, was hired to survey the property and advise as to the best means of development. The construction of the ore processing mill began in 1920. In 1922, the mill began operation with Williams as the manager. The mill processed an average of 35 tons of ore each day. Each ton averaged 3 ounces of gold, worth $62 at 1922 prices. In the 1975 gold market, these would be worth about $450. Processed ore came out of the mill after its free gold was removed. This processed ore, called tailings, was dumped nearby in piles that eventually grew to be the size of hills. It was known that there was much gold yet in the tailings. Biggs is a former employee of the Hirst-Chichagof Mining Company.
I went out as purser on the Virginia 4 on a powder trip. And while I was out there, I was employed for 6 weeks or 2 months, which wound up I was there 15 years. I was born in Juneau, Alaska, January 18th, 1904. I started taking pictures in 1911. Juneau was about in the population of about 900 and along about 1908 or 9. And Douglas was almost as large. They were all planked streets or planked or gravel. There's no paved streets. I went to school here through grade school and over 3 years of high school, and I also worked after school on Saturdays when I was going to high school. Worked in grocery store, worked for the Empire paper, I was a telegraph messenger one time. Well, I took pictures all the time I was out there, photographs from 1928. Through 1943, when the mine closed. The single men eat in the company boarding house, and they paid $40 a month out of their salary for board and room. Miners got $6 a day, and the hoistmen got $5.50 a day, about the same pay as the Alaska Juneau was paying at the time. When I first went out there, it was Prohibition time. So they had a beer club where we each paid in $5 a month, and that bought all the supplies for making a homebrew. The rule was 3 days in a bottle before you could drink it. We had several scares there. The prohibition officers were supposed to be coming out. And one time we dumped I had dumped everything out, and then that didn't materialize. And just before repeal, the cabin burnt down. They got the fire too hot under the brew, and the cabin caught fire and burnt down. There were a few families there, and we all had parties. This is a wedding. It's a funny thing, when I went out there, I was the youngest man there. And after I'd been there 20 or 15 years, some of the younger men that came out just tried to call me Dad. During the late 30s and early 40s, the fishing was very good on the outside of the west coast of Chichagof Island. And they're getting trout ready to salt or smoke, and they have those are Dolly Varden trout hanging there. The radio station was located on an island called Radioville. The operator of it was Joe Bauer, a retired master sergeant, and had a partner living with him, a Finn named John Soiney. They had a garden of all kinds of vegetables and flowers. And he had geese and ducks and goats and chickens, and he had quite a place out there. He was paid the regular rates for the messages plus a bonus by the two mining companies. They made homebrew and wine during Prohibition days, but very seldom any of it got in the bottles. They got it drank up before it got into the bottles. During 1929, when they finished the power line over the hill, we got an engineer named Bill Kiefer, and he'd done the installation, and when everything was practically all in, he was electrocuted, and I witnessed that electrocution. He was in the transformer house by a switch, and he was bragging about what a good job he'd done. And he put his hand on a supposedly insulated wire carrying 6,600 volts, and I see his hand close on it. And he was on the line side of the switch, so I tried to pull the switch, and that didn't do any good. Finally, I found a broom there. With the broom handle, I pried his hand off of the wire, but it was too late. We worked on him for several hours, but we couldn't bring him around. The miners, most of the miners were Slavonians from southern Europe, Yugoslavia, Serbians. Most of them had originally come from Butte. The mining system out of Chichagof was about the same as Butte, and the superintendent was from Montana, so he was partial to those miners because they were used to that method of mining. We had a fellow commit suicide there one time, and we had a terrible time finding enough citizens to serve on the coroner's jury because these miners were all Slavonians and they weren't citizens. We finally got this coroner's jury together, and one of them suggested a verdict that the man died of rigor mortis. The men went down to work in a skip. It's like a hoist, you know. When I signaled to the hoistman, it was both by bells and lights. So these light flashes give them the signal when to hoist. Then they hauled the ore up in the same skip, dumped in a pocket up here, and then drew it into cars and took it to the mill. There's the our small locomotive, and it's a storage battery, locomotive run by Edison storage batteries, which had to be charged every day. Well, the ore was dumped in the mill bin, and through a, passed over a grizzly, the fine ore went down into one bin, and the coarse ore went into another bin, which, and later that was crushed finer by a jaw crusher, and then fed into the stamp mill batteries. There were five stamps to a battery, and two batteries, that's 10 stamp mill. The 10 stamp were run by a camshaft that raised each stamp alternately and dropped it. And the stamps went up and down again, striking against the dies in the bottom here, and ground up the ore, crushed the ore, and went through a 100 mesh screen.
And then passed over the amalgamation plates. Well, the amalgamation plates were copper plates, silver plated, and they were treated with the mercury, a quicksilver, and polished.
Quicksilver had an affinity for gold and silver, so that the free gold and silver was picked up by the quicksilver on the plates.
Free gold passing over these plates formed an amalgam with the quicksilver.
And every 2 hours they had to sweep up the amalgam off these plates, put more quicksilver on, polish the plates, and then start the mill up again for the next run, and that happened about every 2 to 4 hours.
Now, mercury was distilled off. That gold residue, called retort sponge, was melted in an oil furnace in a graphite crucible and poured into a bullion mold.
By the time the mill closed in 1943, it had produced almost $3 million in gold, or at 1975 gold prices, more than $15 million.
I was mine bookkeeper, storekeeper, timekeeper, postmaster. I was postmaster for the last 10 years I was there.
I witnessed all the melting of the gold bullion and pouring of the gold bullion, and I was one of the ones that signed the record of each gold bar that was produced.
We sent the gold bricks by registered mail. At that time, the government had a special rate of 2 cents an ounce plus the register fee. 1932, we started to retreat the tailings that were there. So they hauled them up in a scraper with a steam engine, with a scraper up this ramp into a bin, drew them into cars. Then the cars went up the tramway and dumped the tailings into the top of the mill bin, and they were run through the mill again and through the flotation plant because they were quite a good recovery from them, from that operation.
On an island with no roads or bridges, the Hirst-Chichagof mine had to have all supplies and equipment brought in by boat. During World War II, it became more and more difficult for the mine to obtain manpower and replacement equipment due to the war effort. Eventually, the mine was forced to close in 1943, despite the fact that there were still millions of dollars worth of gold in the ground. Was maintained during its closure. The shafts were kept pumped dry and the buildings protected by caretakers. In 1950, the board of directors decided to reopen the mine. The mine was mortgaged to the B.M. Barron's Bank of Juneau in order to raise the money. Equipment and manpower were hauled in to reopen the shafts and start up the mill. The equipment broke down continuously, and replacements could not be obtained quickly enough. the mine shafts flooded and could not be pumped out. The attempt to reopen was given up. The mortgage could not be repaid, and through foreclosure, the B.M. Barron's Bank of Juneau became the owner of the Hirst-Chichagof gold mine. It doesn't take long for the southeastern Alaska wilderness to reclaim its own. Vandals and souvenir hunters speed the process. Old-time prospectors got permission to rework the tailings. They burned the wooden mill buildings in order to get at the gold dust that had sifted into the cracks and corners over the years. About someday trying to reopen the mine. Gold remains within Duth Mountain and beneath the waters of Kimshan Cove. The price of gold is too low to pay the enormous costs of reconstructing the mine. And so, the gold by the sea rests in peace.